Did Russians know about the RBMK design flaws before the Chernobyl disaster? Would you be surprised if I told you that they did? Not only because of the previous troubles with these reactors, but even long before building and starting the first one. Watch carefully, and you will learn why the corrupted USSR system produced one of the greatest dangers in human history. The last two episodes were dedicated to the general history of RBMK design. In the first one, we told you about the overall situation in the USSR regarding nuclear energy. And in the second one, we were speaking about the Leningrad nuclear power plant incident. This time, we'll focus on the design itself and the story behind its commissioning. I hope you will enjoy this video as much as the previous ones. Let's start. RBMK Nuclear Reactor History, Part 3. Poor design, economic stagnation, and political desire for power. If you watched the previous episode of this miniseries, you know that there was a partial meltdown in the RBMK reactor in Leningrad. It was 1975, so years before Chernobyl units were even installed, not to mention launched. This particular event showed a crucial flaw in the RBMK design. From the previous episode, you could also learn that it was chosen because of political and economic reasons, not exactly because of its overall performance and safety. But last time, I didn't mention a very important detail from the whole creation process of the new era USSR nuclear reactor. Sredmash, or more officially, the Ministry of Medium Machine Building, the base of Soviet nuclear technology hidden behind a mild name, started gathering specialists and different projects for the new kind of reactor. There were a few of them, but two were the most important. One was the RBMK. The second one was dismissed as too Western-like. But between the official lines, one could read that the USSR lacked processes and equipment to manufacture necessary parts. The RBMK plan won. Credits for its design were assigned to one person and the manufacturing began. Not before a lot of high-ranking officials from the Communist Party celebrated behind closed doors. Here they were, in the Soviet Union, seeing a huge milestone in the USSR's nuclear dream right before their eyes. But the small circle of initiated politicians knew a bit more, and their celebration was premature. When the Ministry of Medium Machine Building got the plans, they were happy to hear that it could be produced fully in Leningrad's machinery plant. The same plant built tanks and tractors, but adjusting it to its new task was simple. But after closely looking at the RBMK plans, Sredmash dismissed them. They realized the reactor built accordingly to those plans would be flawed. Especially one person warned that it was too dangerous to be constructed already, not to mention started and operated in urbanized areas. He was a member of the Kurchatov Institute, the same academic organization as the leading designer of the RBMK, and that designer was also a director of the institute. If you ask how this warning was treated in that kind of situation, you may fill in the blanks by yourself. Another scientist raised questions about a very significant matter, a positive void coefficient. He warned that it could make the new reactor potentially prone to explosion. As you may guess, these warnings were also dismissed, as well as their author. They just fired the poor guy as they questioned his loyalty to the Soviet Union and the communist ideas. He didn't resign yet, as he started writing letters. They were not initially recognized, but at some point, they reached the Central Committee of the Communist Party and the Soviet Council of Members, the highest political institutions in the USSR. Nonetheless, it was too late. Despite the warnings, the Soviets built the first RBMK, installed in Leningrad's power plant, and launched it. When they commissioned it, it didn't reach its maximum power, which wasn't anything unusual as they didn't want to risk it all, playing with open cards. They were treading carefully, but nonetheless, the Leningrad's Unit 1, the first of its kind, already revealed its weakness to its operators. it became clear to both the power plant workers and the Sredmash that the RBMK project was rushed too much. The designers were trying to achieve goals too quickly and oversaw some serious flaws. Many of those were revealed quickly. Others took months or even years to become visible. When the second one was still being built, the construction of two other nuclear power plants has already begun, Chernobyl and Kursk. And the first problem appeared with what the whistleblower warned about, the positive void coefficient. It was a major drawback in RBMK graphite water reactor. It was just prone to lose control over the chain reaction if there was a significant coolant reduction. This was because the RBMK was designed in such a way that made it cheaper. If a typical nuclear reactor lost a lot of coolant, it still could be operated in a few ways. In the RBMK, that crucial level of coolant was just much higher, meaning it was more susceptible to any fluctuations. Because the RBMK in Leningrad was the first of its kind, Sredmash and its designers made it some sort of experimental laboratory. But even though some of them knew about the design flaws, they were still surprised at how different the reactor behaved from what they predicted when preparing its plans. As it showed later, they made bad decisions several times over the course of years. Continuously, they ignored the warnings and decided not to examine the reports too closely, probably because they knew if they would be made more official, it couldn't be hidden so easily. Because of that, even though the RBMK reactors became operational in several power plants and this whole project went into full scale, none of the operators outside a very small inner circle knew about these flaws. The positive void coefficient problem meant that the reactor could be more unstable at the point where no one would ever imagine. So as a result, there was an ongoing risk, a probable scenario that some operators would push a reactor behind a thin line which they didn't even know about. And that could induce another partial meltdown or even a full meltdown in any of the working RBMK reactors. But nonetheless, not even the Sredmash and other specialists would accept the thought that one of these reactors could explode. Not until the fatal night of April 26th, 1986. Not until Chernobyl. Thanks for watching. This was another episode of our RBMK history miniseries. If you are interested in other Chernobyl-related knowledge and trivia, check out our Chernobyl Stories playlist. Let me know in the comments what other subject would you like to hear about. I would be happy to prepare a video. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.